Hey everyone, good morning and welcome to BFC Live. My name is Camden, and whether you're joining me for our 9 a.m. or our 11 a.m. worship service today, I'm so glad that you're here joining me. Today is the first Sunday in November, which means that the fall weather is finally here in Oklahoma. It's been hot all throughout the summer and early fall, but fall weather is here, which means I get to wear my long sleeves and not look like a crazy person running around the streets. I'm so glad that fall weather is here. It's my favorite time of year. But November brings another exciting thing here at the church. We have baptisms on November 24th, and I would love to get you connected with our community engagement pastor and get you set up with baptism if you would like to participate on the 24th. Baptism is a sacrament in the church where we symbolize the new identity that we're given in Christ. You will be dunked underwater and then brought up. Everyone in the room is going to be cheering with you. Everyone's going to be celebrating with you as we celebrate your new identity in Christ. It's an awesome time in the church as we celebrate what God is doing in your lives, in the lives of our church. And it's so beautiful. I love baptism every time we do it. I love being a part of it. So if you are interested in being a part of baptism on the 24th, there'll be a QR code that'll come across the screen. Take your phone out real quick while we're in this portion of the service. We're about to start worship, but take your phone out, scan that QR code, and let me know in the text box line that you're interested in baptisms, and I'll get you set up with some people who will make sure that you are here on the 24th for baptisms. Today, we are on week 4 of our sermon series, On Purpose, and Pastor Rick is out this week, but we'll be blessed by Pastor Brent Hardesty. We've heard from Pastor Brent before multiple times. He always brings an incredible message, and today we're looking at 1 Thessalonians 4, 1 through 8, and God's will for us to be holy in Him. God is holy, and He desires for us to be holy, just as He is holy. That's how we were created, but it's because of our decisions that we aren't. But God gives us the purpose of being holy again. He alone is holy, and we get to be holy because of His call and His purpose for our lives. So let's go ahead and get started with worship today, and then hear our message from Pastor Brent.
The Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So we've come to experience that this morning. In His presence, He makes all things new. We worship Him today with all that we have. Come on, let's sing together. Step out of the shadows, step out of the grave, break into the wild. Free. Run. of Jesus today. We worship him. Come on, let's sing it. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. And lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Sing that again. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. This morning, he says, I will give thanks to the Lord because of his righteousness. I will sing praises of the name of the Lord Most High. That's why we've come today, to give him all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Come on, let's sing it together.
Thank you. presented into your mind or your thought process this morning just what is possible because Jesus' body didn't stay in a grave. What's possible for you in your life, for your circumstances, for our country, for its circumstances? What is possible today because there's nobody in the grave now? That's a big thanks be to God moment right there. Well, this week's a big week in America and perhaps around the world. A presidential election, and it's a big deal. While we are citizens of this country on this earth, I want to remind you that the moment we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, we also become citizens of the kingdom of God. And the expectations are completely different. Philippians 3:20 says, "But our citizenship is in heaven." And Hebrews 11:13 refers to Christians as foreigners and strangers on this earth. So Jesus reminds us that we are in the world, but not of the world. So what sets us apart? It's the holy love of God. It's the holy love of God. And this world desperately needs to see the reflection of the holy love of God in my life and yours this week. I have no idea what this week holds. I'm not here to peddle fear. I'm here to tell you that Jesus is alive and with us, and we need him desperately in this time. We get to vote. In fact, I believe we have a responsibility to do so, and I believe we should do that. We want to make the world a better place. That's not primarily up to who is president. That's primarily up to how we live our lives in our neighborhood and with our people. Are we leading people to Jesus? Are we reflecting that holy love of God? We change the world one person at a time as we make disciples. That's what Jesus told us to be doing between when he left and when he promises to return. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we love you. Thank you for your presence here in this room. We thank you for the promise that we live into. Help us to lean all the way into what it means to live well, to live different, because your son's body didn't stay in a grave. What an awesome thought. What is possible for us today? Lord, I'm praying specifically for our country this morning. I'm praying for the citizens of this country, that we would do what we ought to do, that we'd honor you in that. I'm praying that your peace would come, and that it would come through me, and it would come through good folks like these, that we would take the peace of Christ and the hope of Christ with us everywhere we go all week. Lord, I know that for some there's anxiety. Would you help us with what it means for our attention to be fully on you, who you are, what is within your grasp? Lord, help us to not be worrying about these things, but to live fully into who you are and what it means for us to be your people in this day and in this time. We trust you. We love you. We believe you have good plans for us. And we believe someday you'll come back. We long for that day, but until that day, help us with what it means to live as your children and you as our God. Now, would you pray with me the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
Isn't it so good to be together this morning? My name is Misty Jaggers, and I have the privilege of serving on staff here at BFC. And I also have the privilege of welcoming a very special group to worship with us this morning. We have our BFC kids and preteens with us. We love that we are an intergenerational church, and we love worshiping together with our kids and preteens on Family Worship Sundays. We also love connecting with you. So if this is your first time to worship with us, or maybe you've been worshiping with us for a while and we just haven't had a chance to meet you yet, we would love to connect with you. Truly, sincerely, would love to walk with you on your faith journey. You can find a connect card under the armrest there at your seat. Fill it out and drop it in the Give and Connect boxes at the exit of our sanctuary, or scan the QR code on the screen. Fill in all of your information and one of our pastors will follow up with you this week. Just a few weeks ago, we had the opportunity to celebrate 18 baptisms in our morning services. Absolutely. That is 18 lives changed through the transformational holy love of God. Maybe you are ready to take that next step in your faith journey and explore that next step of baptism. If that is you, you can find more information on our website at bethanynaz.org/baptism, or you can indicate that on that connect card, drop it in the box, and we'll get back with you with more details about our upcoming baptism service on November 24th. God is moving in powerful ways through you and through the ministries of BFC, and that is only possible because of your faithful giving. One of our values at BFC is living generously, and every week we are blessed by the ways that you all live generously through serving and through giving. Thank you for maintaining your faithfulness in that. There are a number of different ways you can give. You can give online, through the app, or by dropping your gift in the Give and Connect boxes at the exit of our sanctuary. It's been an incredible morning already. We're so thankful you're here with us today. Now let's continue to worship.
Stand with us as we bless his name together.
Blessed are those who run to him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake them. And blessed are those who seek his face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your voice with me. He's worthy.
When my hands are empty, bless God with the
praise the cosmic. Bless God when nobody's watching. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when the weapons form.
Went to bed on purpose last night thinking I'm going to get an extra hour of sleep. And then the weather happened. I know we had some young ladies that were on retreat last night. Did woo, woo, right? Give them a shout out. I'm told they slept right through the tornado sirens. And that's good. That's a good thing. I did not, because I have a special alarm clock that sleeps next to me that wakes me up when stuff like that's going on. And so she did wake me up, and then at about 1:30, the power went out at our house. It's not back on yet. I checked just a minute ago, and it was a little bit crazy. Now, it was at 1:30. I don't know if it was the first 1:30 or the second 1:30, because there were two of them last night. Whichever one it was terrible. And shortly after that, you know, you flip on every light trying to get all the way to the, we call it the Frady hole at our house. It's in the garage and you can get in there. And usually I prepare that well for my wife before it's time to get in, but there was no preparation last night. We just went and got in it and listened for a while and then, you know, dealt with whatever we dealt with this morning. I got dressed in the dark and it was all kinds of fun. I didn't get an extra hour of sleep. What about you? Years ago, 1994, actually, I had just started dating my wife, and it was 1994, and we just started dating. But on the night of the fall back in the fall that year, I was serving as an interim youth pastor at Nashville First Church of the Nazarene, and I was ready to go. I was ready to like get up and get after it, and I did not. My mind was way too much on this young lady and not so much on taking care of things like time changes. And so I went to bed. I woke up. There were no phones or any automatic systems. If you didn't change it, it didn't happen. So I got up, got in my car, drove to Nashville First Church of the Nazarene, got there, and there is nobody there. And I'm scared because I've been to youth camp and I've seen the videos. I've watched the movies. I have no idea what's going on. Now, there was a lot of people that got quite a bit of laughter at my expense later when they found it, because I was never the first one there. It happened. And there it is. So today we're going to continue the series on purpose in our journey through 1 Thessalonians. Before I get too far into it, I want to take just a moment and remind us of Paul's purpose. Give us a little bit of background to this story. Paul's purpose, he was serious about it. He was passionate about it. He was on task pretty much all the time. I think he's a type A kind of guy. Acts 26 tells us clearly what drove the Apostle Paul on his missionary journeys and really every day of his new life. The new life that happened after he met the living Jesus, who was died but resurrected and ascended, but showed up on the road to Damascus to Saul and changed his life, changed his name, changed everything about him and gave him a new purpose. For every one of us here, we've been saved from something and to something. And I want you to hear what that is, because Paul in Acts chapter 26 is explaining that to an authority named King Agrippa. He's telling his story, and I'll share just a portion of it with you. He says, Jesus said to me, but get up and stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you to serve and testify to the things in which you have seen me and those in which I will appear to you. I will rescue you from your people and from the Gentiles to whom I am sending you, to open their eyes, so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. So driven by this purpose and passion, Paul, along with Timothy and Silas, went to Thessalonica, and they introduced the people there to Jesus. This is powerful. It's wonderful. Jesus came to Thessalonica. He showed up there. We can read more about that in Acts chapter 17, and we'll look into that in a few months. But I want to ask you right now, what do you remember about when Jesus first came to you? I want to remind you that you did not first come to Jesus. Jesus came to you. If Jesus didn't come to you, there's no finding him. He came to you. What do you remember about that? You remember the weight being lifted? Remember peace that couldn't be explained any other way? Remember the weight of guilt and shame just kind of being gone? What do you remember about that? I want you to think about that for just a second. Jesus came to Thessalonica with Paul. He gave him hope for life and great hope for the future. So much so that as some of their loved ones experienced death before Jesus' promised return, they were concerned. So let's look at the passage and hear Paul's response to this concern. So we'll read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, begin at verse 13. He says, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others who do, who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will all be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there's peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, as indeed you are doing. This is the word of God for the people of God. And all God's people said, thanks be to God. You sound good this morning. So Paul clearly reassures his readers that Jesus will return in glory and that their loved ones will certainly be included. This passage is packed with imagery. He's preaching quite the message. He's got so many different kinds of images going on, and I want to share just a couple of them with you. Many have attempted to translate for us, sometimes in some pretty creative ways with movies and such. But I want to tell you what the scripture tells us, what the passage tells us this morning. Chapter 4, verse 16, I want to remind you, says, for the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven. I remember being at a youth camp quite a few years ago, and, you know, by Thursday night, kids are ready. Kids are ready. And I love those moments. I love those kinds of moments. And I don't know whose idea it was. It was not my idea. I had nothing to do with this, but there was a Thursday night, and the pastor, the preacher was preaching, and they were ready for the very end of the service, and from the back, someone decided that it was a good time to blow a trumpet, and they blew a trumpet, and kids ran to the altars, like, tripping over each other, like, I'm getting to the altars. I'm like, maybe between the trumpet just sounded, and I can, maybe there's still time for me. I want to remind you first and foremost that in two places in this passage, at the end of chapter 4 and then at verse 13 in chapter 5, it doesn't say scare each other to death with these messages. It doesn't say create anxiety. It doesn't say it says encourage one another with these words. That's what it says. Encourage one another with these words. So we have this passage in 4:16. It talks about the trumpet and the descending from heaven. The dead in Christ will rise first, and then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. If you read this and then you go into Exodus and read the passages that have to do with Moses coming down off the mountain he's been with the Lord for all these days, and he has the tablets. He's heard from God. He's ready to share what he's heard from God with his people. And it's that kind of a scene. Trumpets and smoke and glory and beauty and wow. This section also draws on the image of a king or a governor who's declared a project. Hey, I want you to do this in Thessalonica, right? As if the emperor would have said, hey, do this in Thessalonica. I want you to be about this kind of project. And then he comes back to Thessalonica to come check on the progress on the work. How's that going? I want to see it. And so if that were to happen, what was very traditional in that time was that the people of the town or the province, where it is, would go out on the road to meet the emperor when he's coming, to escort him back in so that we can show him what we've been doing with his commands, with his directives, with his vision. We're admonished to encourage each other with these words. We will be with the Lord forever. Look at your neighbor and say, we're going to be with the Lord forever. Go ahead. Tell them. Encourage. Did you say it in a real encouraging way? Because that's what we're supposed to do. We're going to be with the Lord forever. No more time changes. I should have got a thanks be to God. I don't know. Let me recap for just a minute. Jesus has come to the Thessalonians and to us, and Jesus will return. What a promise. You know, there's another section in this passage where it talks about someone saying, peace and security, peace and security. My wife and I got to travel to Rome this past spring, and our tour guide, when we were in the Colosseum, was, I'd say, full-on Roman. She was full-on Roman. She was still preaching Pax Romana, and if all of people like us hadn't messed that up, then we'd still be living under Pax Romana. Well, that was preached heavy and hard from all the politicians, all the people of power. Don't worry about all this stuff going on all over the place. Just keep your eyes set on peace and security, peace and security. And somehow in the middle of just someone saying it pointlessly, aimlessly, as if they could create that with their own vision. They couldn't. They didn't have the power to. And somewhere in the middle of that, these things are going to take place. So Jesus has come to the Thessalonians and to us, and Jesus will return. We have that promise. That's so fantastic. It's great news, but I want to share with you what I believe to be the very best news. Jesus is with them. Yes, he came. Yes, he's coming again, but Jesus is with them right now. Jesus is with us right now. Thank you. We're not supposed to be afraid of that, folks. It's not a tornado warning. It's encouraging words. Jesus is with us right now. How do we know that? How do we know that? We aren't always aware. We can't always sense his presence, but Jesus is with us. And how do we know that? Well, we know that because in chapter 5, Paul calls them children of light, children of the day. They are the children of the light. Who is the light of the world? Jesus is the light of the world. How are they children of the light except that the light was with them, living among them? Chapter 5, verse 9 says, "For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him." That's present perfect language. That means we live with him now. We will live with him tomorrow. We will live with him on Tuesday. And believe it or not, when we wake up Wednesday morning, no matter what Tuesday holds, we'll still be with Jesus and he'll still be with us. How else do we know? Well, we know because, well, John 1:5 says, "The light was shining in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it." One of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. Because sometimes it's kind of dark. Sometimes the circumstances are pretty heavy. But the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness never overcomes the light. You walk into a dark room and you shine a light, it's no longer a dark room. The light wins every time. And these are children of the light. Well, what does that mean? It means that every place they showed up, even though there's hardship going on in Thessalonica, even though there's pressure from the authorities, even though there's hardship and all this stuff going on, everywhere they go, light shines in the darkness. That's for us too. How do we know that Jesus is with them? Well, just before Jesus ascended into heaven in Matthew 28, he said, "And remember, I am with you always to the very end of the age. I am with you." What is it like when Jesus ascended into heaven? What happened in that moment? Do you think Jesus was standing on the hill and then it says he was taken up into the clouds and then he disappeared from their sight, and then the two angels came back and gave some instructions to the guy, said, "Hey, here's what I want you to be doing. You need to be doing this while he's gone. He's going to come back the way he said. Why are you standing here? Why are you standing here looking into the clouds? Do what he said." When Jesus ascended, he didn't go light years away somewhere. I love it when Pastor Rick and other writers that I love to read talk about thin places. These thin places. Jesus disappeared. He vanished from their sight, but he didn't go light years away. He's right here. He promised he wasn't going away very far. I'm going to be right here. And he's here with us right now today. We know because while Paul was in Athens, he left Thessalonica, he went to Athens so that they didn't kill him in that moment, and he's writing a letter from Athens back to Thessalonica, and while he's doing that, he's sharing with these words with the people in Athens. He's talking about what it means for people to find a God they didn't know, but you can know this God. He said, but you can know this God. You can turn from darkness to light. You can turn from the power of Satan to God. You can turn. This is my purpose in life. He gave it to me, and I want to share it with you. You can know this God. In fact, he says, "From one ancestor, he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being. God is near. Here's what I want you to know for sure this morning. Jesus came. He came to the Thessalonica, and he came to us. Jesus is coming. He promised to return. I can't wait. What about you? I can't wait. I'm ready. There's a lot of times I'm like, you know, Jesus, if you want to come back before Monday morning staff meeting, that's cool. Come on. In fact, before I get on I-35, please, just come on. I'm good. Let's go. And Jesus is with us now. I've been privileged to travel a lot of places. And then quite a few years ago, my family went to Alaska. And when we were in Alaska, we had been once before. We didn't get to see Denali. Denali is Mount McKinley. They call it the Great One. 20,320 feet. It blows those 14ers in Colorado away by 6,000 feet. It's amazing. It's an unbelievable thing. Problem is, only a third of the people who ever go to see it. And here's why. Because it has its own weather systems. And I stood for hours one day and watched clouds just kind of swirl. And there's some people around and they're saying, oh, no, it's right over there. It's right over there. And like, I see clouds. I can see those in Oklahoma. Clouds. That looks a lot like Oklahoma some places. You know, those little mountains down south. There you go. And you're like, yeah. And we stood there for hours, and we looked, and we kept thinking, maybe the clouds will, there are people telling us, oh, I've seen it, it's there, just hang on a little bit more. Eventually, time had passed, and we had to go, we had to get back to Anchorage, so we left the place where we were here looking, and we got on the road, and we were driving down the road in the RV, and once we got a certain ways down the road, I looked in the rearview mirror, happened to peek in the rearview mirror, and I was like, stop! I yelled to my father-in-law, stop! And it was amazing, because when I said stop, it was like every other car on the road heard me, because everybody starts pulling over, and everybody starts getting out of their cars and standing in the middle of a highway and looking at this. Wow. Denali. They call her the Great One. It was unbelievable. And literally, people like got out of their cars and just stood in the road. It didn't matter if you were in the road because nobody was driving. Everybody was stopping to look at her. It's like, and then I stood in the middle of the road and I thought, where were you hiding? What was going on that I couldn't see you? All I could see was this, and I couldn't see you. And I'm standing in the middle of a road in Alaska looking at a mountain, and I'm having this little conversation with God saying, hey, how come sometimes I know you're there, but I can't see you? Why are you hiding? How are you doing that? Jesus is always with us. We are not always aware of him. Jesus isn't hiding from us. We are terribly distracted. In practicing the way of Jesus, that is, John Mark Comer is quoting Dallas Willard, who says, the first and most basic thing we can and must do is keep God before our minds. This is the fundamental secret of caring for our souls. Our part in thus practicing the presence of God is to direct and redirect our minds constantly to him. In the early time of our practicing, we may well be challenged by our burdensome habits of dwelling on things less than God. Everything is in the category of less than God. We may well... be challenged by our burdensome habits of dwelling on things less than God. That is, we will be constantly distracted by a million other things. But these are habits, not the law of gravity. And it can be broken. A new grace-filled habit will replace our former ones as we take intentional, purposeful steps toward keeping God before us. Soon our minds will return to God as the needle of a compass constantly returns to the north. If God is the great longing of our souls, he will become the pulsar, the north star of our inward beings. So what has your attention? To what are you tending right now? Political news? social media, millions of sound bites, countless other distractions, all kinds of things competing for our attention, and we end up tending those things. And frankly, I think we might actually be living in the most impatient culture ever. Tish Warren in the Liturgy of the Ordinary says, God intended man to have all good, but in God's time. And if you remember Eve in the garden, God would give everything good to Adam and Eve. But Satan made her believe, helped her to believe, deceived her into believing that God's trying to withhold something good from you, and if you'll short-circuit this little deal, you can get it faster. You can have this now. Oh, we got it now. We got a mess now. Abraham, hey, God's going to keep his promise, but you're going to have to help him with that, so I think maybe you ought to do this and do that. Oh, that fixed everything. Thanks a lot, Abraham. We do that. Instead of waiting, instead of having our attention on God, we short-circuit things. We say, oh, maybe I should do this, maybe I should do that. Well, he's waiting for me to be still and know that I'm God. That's what he says. Wait for him. Patience is the basic constituent of Christianity. The power to wait, to persevere, to hold out, to endure to the end. Not to transcend one's own limitations, not to force issues by playing the hero or the titan, but to practice the virtue that lies beyond heroism, the meekness of the lamb which is led, the one that looks like it's been slain. When I was a sophomore in college, I had gone home from Nashville, Tennessee. I went to school at Trevecca Nazarene University. I'd gone to that little small town I'm from in Ohio, in Coshocton, Ohio, and I on the way home, going through Columbus that evening, it was a Friday evening, I got my very first speeding ticket, didn't deserve that one. I've deserved quite a few others I didn't get, but I didn't deserve that one. Before that night was over, I'd wrapped my car around a tree and walked home. And it was a bad weekend. It was starting out really, really bad. Not long throughout the week, the friend that was with me on the trip, he and I found a car, a VW Bug, and we were going to drive the Bug at the end of spring break back from my home back to Nashville, Tennessee. And instead of taking the straight route, my dad says, hey, you know what? Call me when you get in. Same story every time. Call me when you get in. Okay, Dad, you bet. And we left my hometown and we went to Columbus, Ohio. We stopped and talked to some friends at Ohio State. And then we got back in the car and we went to the University of Cincinnati and we talked to some friends in Cincinnati. And so by the time we left the University of Cincinnati, I should have already been in Nashville, but I was still a long way from where I should have been. We kept going down through Louisville, Kentucky, and we got 15 miles south of Louisville, Kentucky, to the right near an exit for a place called Shepherdsville, Kentucky. And that little sound that a VW Bug makes when it's rolling, it stopped making that sound. It was right out of gas. And I'm like, how do you know it's out of gas? My friend was driving. He's like, well, it just stopped. I was like, okay, it's out of gas. Why is it out of gas? Well, the needle wasn't moving. Maybe you should have checked that. We pushed the car off the highway, up the on-ramp, over to a gas station. It was closed. Of course it was. It was about 4 a.m. by this time. And a few hours later, they started to open up and people had come by, and they didn't really care for the two of us in their little town. Pretty soon, I made a phone call to my dad, and my friend called his dad. I said, hey, Dad, are you home? No, I'm sorry. I'm in Shepherdsville, Kentucky. Car broke down. Not sure what we're going to do. They're towing the car. Okay. So they towed the car. It went to a little shop. There were six guys in big guys, bib overalls, and they went to the front of that VW Bug, and one of them popped that thing and raised the hood and looked in there and said, I ain't never seen nothing like that. If you don't know, the motor on a VW Bug is in the back. I thought, oh no, we're in big trouble. I don't even know where to look for the motor. We waited. We talked. We struggled. A few hours later, my dad showed up wearing dress pants and a sport coat. And with all the mechanics standing around looking at my dad, the computer guy, And he said to my friend, David, would you get in the front and would you turn the key when I kind of tap on this? And so my dad sticks his hand up in the back end of that car and does something. I still don't know what he did, but he did something, said, okay, tap, tap, and boom, car started right up. And then he looked at my friend and he said, hey, Dave, would you mind driving the rest of the way to Nashville and Brent ride with me? And I thought, oh boy, here it comes. I deserve everything I'm about to get. What happened was, Dad took us to eat. Said, you hungry? Yeah, Dad, we're hungry. He took us to get something to eat. And then we rode the rest of the way to Nashville. And he didn't tell me everything I did wrong. We talked about baseball, and we talked about life, and we talked about our family. And then he hugged me. And he took a shower in my dorm room, and he turned around and went home. But let me tell you what my dad did. My dad found me in my mess. He fixed the problem. He fed me and cleaned me up, and he went the rest of the way home with me. And that's what Jesus did for the Thessalonians. And that's what Jesus is here to do for you. It's possible you'd say, I wish I had a dad like that. You do. You do. And he wants to meet with you this morning. He wants to help you this morning. So here's what I want for you. I want for you to live for hope. I want you to live with hope. I want you to live with expectancy. I want you to live attentive to the living Christ. I want you to live and walk in the light of Jesus. I want you to see Jesus. Good news, brothers and sisters, he's here right now. Now, on the way in, you received a small package. And in that package is some bread and some juice. I'd love it if right now you would take the bread and hold it in your hand. And I'd tell you that Jesus himself, on the night that he was betrayed, he shared these words with his disciples. It was the kind of thing that says, I'm here, I'm with you, and I'm coming again. He says, while they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it and gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body. And then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins. And then he had this tag. He said, I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in my Father's kingdom. And as we remove the lid and drink the juice this morning, I want you to believe that I believe, not somewhere light years away, but very close by, is the presence of the Father and the Son and the Spirit. And right now they're saying, hey, is it time? Can we go get our kids? Can we go get these ones that we love? Is it time for us to share this meal together that's so meaningful to our people? Father, we want to see you. We're grateful for the work of your Son in our lives. We are grateful. Lord, we can't just stand around looking up in the clouds. We can't just be hanging out waiting. Lord, we want to be busy doing what you ask us to do so that when you come back, we come to meet you and show you what we've been up to. And we're grateful for the signs of life that we see here, for celebrating baptisms and new folks coming to Jesus. And Lord, we just believe there's more and more and more that I want to see Jesus. God, I want so many other of my friends to see you too. So would you help us in these moments while we wait, to be waiting actively and purposefully, on purpose for you with hope. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Something more. Give me old, give me new.
just want to sing the truth here in these praises. Let me see Jesus. Isn't he wonderful?
Oh,
Your hands as if you were receiving a gift today. It's the final part of our service today, the benediction. May the God of all power, of all strength, and wisdom, and might go before you this week. May you be reminded that He stands behind you, He stands beside you, He's all around you. As you face adversity, may you be reminded that His presence lifts you out of those circumstances. May you wait with anticipation for His return. And may you spread His love to all you come into contact with. God bless you all. You are dismissed.